TED Audio Collective.
Could we make something that wasn't just the science or the art, but it was like this third thing where the text and the paintings really, they supported each other. Like you need one to have the other.
From the TED Audio Collective, this is Design Matters with Debbie Millman. For 18 years, Debbie Millman has been talking with designers and other creative people about what they do, how they got to be who they are, and what they're thinking about and working on. On this episode, artist Lia Halloran and physicist Kip Thorne talk about the importance of trying to visualize our universe.
The visualization is the thing that enables me to make leaps of insight and decide what mathematical calculations to do.
Hey, listener, a quick favor. We are conducting an audience survey, and we'd be really grateful if you could take just a few minutes to respond. Please visit survey.prx.org/designmatters to take the survey today. That's survey.prx.org/designmatters. Thanks.
Astrophysics has proved we had the Big Bang, and there are black holes and undulating space-time, and all manner of nearly unimaginable phenomena. But what do these things look like? We are such a visual species that for most of us without degrees in advanced math, these things don't make a lot of sense unless we can somehow see them. Enter Kip Thorne and Lia Halloran. Kip Thorne is a Nobel Prize winning theoretical physicist as well as a poet. Lia Halloran is a multi-award-winning artist and photographer who is deeply interested in the natural world and science. Together, they have created a book of poetry and paintings called The Warped Side of the Universe, an odyssey through black holes, wormholes, time travel, and gravitational waves. They join me today to talk about their lives and their very cosmic collaboration. Kip Thorne and Lia Halloran, welcome to Design Matters.
Great pleasure to be with you.
Thanks so much for having us.
Absolutely. Kip, is it true that the prize for a scientific bet you won with Stephen Hawking was a subscription to Penthouse magazine?
Yes, that's true. That was a long time ago. That was the era of the 1970s. It was a different era from today.
What was the bet?
The bet was whether a particular object that had been seen with optical telescopes and radio telescopes called Cygnus X-1, also with X-ray telescopes, whether it had a black hole at its center. And I bet that it did. Stephen bet that it did not. He regarded that as a insurance policy, because he had so much riding on it turning out to be a black hole that he figured that he would at least get, for him, it was a subscription to a different magazine, Private Eye, a British magazine. For me, it was Penthouse. And, well, in the end, I won, but it took about 20 years until he signed off.
Ah, okay. Well, good to know. Kip, you were born in Logan, Utah, a town of 16,000 people nestled in a valley in the Rocky Mountains. Your dad was a professor and your mom had a PhD in economics. She was a deeply committed community activist and a feminist and the author of the book Leave the Dishes in the Sink, Adventures of an Activist in Conservative Utah. Was your mom an active member of the community all through your childhood, or did it begin later in life?
Oh, she was very active in the community throughout my childhood and throughout her life. When she died, there were gigantic headlines in the local newspaper, Old Radical Dies. By the standards of conservative Logan, Utah, she was a radical. I think by the standards of Southern California, she would have been very mainstream.
What would you say is the most important thing she taught you?
I think she taught me to investigate things that I was interested in. She took me, when I was age 8, to a talk given by a professor at the local university, a talk about the solar system. And I fell in love with the idea of the solar system with its then 9 planets going around the sun, with these enormous distances between the planets by comparison with their sizes. And she helped me get started on doing various astronomy projects thereafter, and got me to the point quite quickly that I was on my own and I was inventing projects of my own to do. And she was just wonderful with her children and inspiring this way.
I understand before you fell in love with astronomy, you had a deep desire to become a snowplow driver.
Oh, yes, absolutely. The snow in this mountain valley that I grew up in, Cache Valley, in 1948 particularly, it was very deep. And the snow plows in front of our house would push the snow up to a height that could be two or even three times higher than my father was tall. And that was clearly the most powerful job in the whole world. And so, yes, that's what I wanted to be before I fell in love with astronomy.
Once you fell in love with astronomy, I understand that you began to devour everything that you could find about astronomy in the local library and in bookstores. You've said that when you found a paperback copy of 123 Infinity by the physicist George Gamow, you were dazzled. And your description of the book was so compelling, Kip, that I just bought it as well. And it's really a wonderful book. I mean, it's so... I don't want to say it's easy to read because it's not easy to read, but for somebody like me that's more of a fan of physics and astronomy as opposed to anywhere as close to even remotely able to do anything in physics or astronomy, I found it to be really, really enjoyable. What did you find particularly remarkable about it?
The thing that struck me the most and that just totally captivated me was Gamow's description of the laws of physics as controlling the universe, controlling how the universe was born, perhaps, and surely controlling how it has evolved, controlling the kinds of things that have come to exist in the universe. And that was the point at which I decided I wanted to be a theoretical physicist who worked on the laws of physics rather than an astronomer, but one who then focused on how the laws of physics controlled the astronomical universe. And that's what happened.
As a teenager in the 1950s, you played saxophone and clarinet in a dance band. You participated in exhibition dancing, edited the high school yearbook. You were on the high school debate squad.
Well, you know so much about me. It's shocking.
You had quite a lot of range in high school. Did you know what you wanted to do professionally?
Well, I knew I wanted to become a physicist and work in astrophysics. I knew that very clearly from age 13 on.
Even then?
But I knew how to enjoy life as well. And that was another aspect of me from the beginning, is I wanted to enjoy life and I wanted to understand the universe. I wanted to contribute what I could to human understanding of the universe and have fun doing it.
I understand that one of the reasons you chose Caltech for college was that you read that if on an exam you got the wrong answer, but your arguments were good, you could get a decent mark.
That's right.
What did that tell you about Caltech? What did that give you the sense that the school was like?
Well, it gave me a sense that it was a place that did not have rote rules about how things were done, a place that was very reasonable and flexible, that focused on what was important. In this case, when you're a student trying to learn science and how to do science, more important than learning facts was learning how to figure facts out, how to figure things out. And that was the epitome of this statement that I read in Time magazine in 1954, I think it was. It was a euphoric article about Caltech, a cover story about Caltech in Time magazine. And I decided at that point, I'm going to go to Caltech. I'm going to be a student at Caltech, and I want to have a career at Caltech. And, well, here I am.
It was at Caltech that you first developed your interest in black holes. What first intrigued you about this phenomena? Why black holes?
Well, I was intrigued by black holes, but I didn't understand them at all while I was at Caltech. To really understand them, I had to learn in depth Einstein's general relativity and the laws of warped space-time. At Caltech, I just was intrigued by the idea that there would be this object into which things could fall and out of which nothing could come. And I struggled to understand how that could be and how that fit in with the rest of physics. But I didn't really succeed in understanding that until I went to Princeton as a graduate student. And in my early months at Princeton, started to study general relativity under John Wheeler and Bob Dickey, who were two professors there, one of them a great theorist, the other a great experimenter, both working in Einstein's theory of gravity.
It was at Princeton that you began to develop a vision for the future of gravitational wave astronomy. Can you share what a gravitational wave actually is for our listeners?
So a gravitational wave is a, I'm going to describe it in several different ways in order to capture it. First, I can describe it as a ripple in the fabric of space and time that travels at the same speed of as light. A ripple, sort of like a ripple on the surface of the ocean. That doesn't really tell you what you would feel if a gravitational wave went through you. It doesn't really explain in a very clear way what's going on. So what the gravitational wave actually does is it stretches space in one direction perpendicular to the direction it's traveling. So if it's traveling from me to you, then in the perpendicular direction between us, it stretches space in one direction and squeezes space in the perpendicular direction. And then a moment later, it stretches space in the perpendicular direction, squeezes space horizontally. And it's an oscillating stretching and squeezing of space as time goes on. That's not the full story of the gravitational wave. It is also twisting space clockwise and twisting space counterclockwise. So it's a rather rich form of space warping as time passes.
In 1972, Rainier Weiss, the physics professor at MIT, proposed an L-shaped laser interferometer, gravitational wave detector, with free-swinging mirrors whose oscillating separations would be measured via laser interferometry. At the time, you didn't think it was very promising. Why not?
Because I had a pretty good idea how strong the strongest gravitational waves are that pass through the Earth. And they're very, very weak by the time they reach the Earth. What Ray Weiss said is you're going to bounce the light off of mirrors. And so you have interferometry, which enables you to measure to high precision the motion of the two mirrors that it's bouncing back and forth between. And the gravitational waves are enormously larger than the atoms in the mirror. So it just didn't seem to me at all plausible that you could pull this off. I could see that it was conceivable in principle, but in practice, to do this down to 10 million or 100 million times smaller than an atom, where the mirrors are made out of those atoms, the mirrors are bumpy, and the light is bouncing off these bumpy mirrors, and the mirrors are moving by 10 million, 100 million times smaller than those atoms. That was crazy. So it was in the process of writing with my former PhD advisor, John Wheeler at the time, and Charlie Misner, another former student of his, writing a textbook about general relativity. And I was writing a section on ideas for detecting gravitational waves. And so I just mentioned Ray Weiss's idea. And I simply said, it's not very promising. I held back. I didn't say it was crazy. I didn't say he had gone off the deep end. But I was very blunt at that level. It's not very promising.
After you studied Dr. Weiss's report in more depth, you came to consider it a blueprint for the future. And it took many decades of work. But on September 14th, 2015, the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory, or LIGO, began the first search for gravitational waves.
And LIGO what after two or three years of studying his paper and talking with him and with several other colleagues, I became convinced that it had a reasonable shot at success. And so I wound up devoting a large fraction of my career to helping him succeed after having declared that this was not very promising. And as you remarked, by 2015, we did have success.
you spent a lot of your life, as you just said, working on this. What did you think the odds were of success?
I didn't quote odds to anybody. I was vague in the following sense. It was quite clear when we first proposed to build LIGO, our gravity wave detector system of two detectors of this sort, it was clear that we would have to build very expensive facilities and then build a first generation of detectors, and we would very probably not see anything. We by then would have spent several hundred million dollars of taxpayers' money. And then we would have learned enough from these instruments that we had built to be able to design and build the advanced gravity wave detectors or advanced LIGO. What was the odds of success? This depended on two things. It depended on how kind nature was. And I had a fairly good idea of how kind nature was, but we weren't by any means sure. It depended on how good the experimental team was. And by that time, I knew we had the best possible team that could be put together from the best physicists in the world. So my expectation was certainly considerably better than 50-50 odds, that up 80, 90% odds, that if we continued to be funded into the second generation, the advanced detectors, and pushing this advanced detectors all the way up to their design sensitivity, I would have said 90, I didn't quote a number, but I'd say 90, 95% odds that we would succeed at that level. But that level was very far from where we began, very far. And the whole issue is whether we could really get to that level. But I had confidence in this superb team that had been put together. And once we had that team in place, I was feeling pretty optimistic.
LIGO captured a strong signal from the collision of two black holes, 29 and 36 times more massive than our sun, and located 1.3 billion light years from planet Earth. The waves carried away as much energy as would be produced by annihilating three of our suns. After intense scrutiny of the results, the LIGO scientists announced this discovery to the world on February 11th, 2016. What are gravitational waves actually made of?
They're made from a warping of space and time. They're not made from matter. They're not made from electricity or magnetism. They're made from a pure warping of space and time, the stretching of space, the squeezing of space, clockwise twisting of space, counterclockwise twisting of space. And it is really quite remarkable. This is the thing that so excited me as a young man when I came to understand the nature of Einstein's relativity theory, that you could have what I would call a warped side of the universe, objects and phenomena that are made from a deformation, a warping of space and of time.
You've said that gravitational wave astronomy could someday allow direct observation of the earliest history of the universe. And I'm wondering, how would we be able to observe that?
So I expect that it's likely that within the next decade, we will indirectly see the gravitational waves that came from the birth of the universe, indirectly in the following sense, that those waves with very, very long wavelengths, very slow oscillations, wavelengths 1/100th or 1/10th the size of the observable universe, unbelievably long wavelengths, those waves stretched and squeezed the very hot matter in the early universe at the moment that it was emitting, it was producing electromagnetic waves that we now detect, called the cosmic microwave background. The plasma is being stretched and squeezed by the gravitational waves. And as the electromagnetic waves scatter off that plasma, they get an imprint from the gravitational waves that were stretching and squeezing it. And that imprint is what we call a polarization imprint. And that polarization imprint has been seen by cosmologists. However, there are other ways that that polarization imprint can be made in the universe. And the challenge is to separate out the imprint that was produced by the primordial gravitational waves from imprint produced in other manners. And that's what the holy grail of this area of cosmology is today. But it's a holy grail that I think is they're going to pull it off in the coming decade. A more direct observation of these primordial gravitational waves will likely be achieved in the middle of this century by gravitational wave detectors that are very similar to LIGO, but they're out in interplanetary space, something called the Big Bang Observer, but the future gravitational wave space mission. And those will see gravitational waves that oscillate with periods from about a second to a minute. Whereas the ones that put the imprint on this cosmic microwave background, it's periods of 100 million years. And so I think that by the middle of this century, we're likely to be observing the primordial gravitational waves directly or indirectly in very two different frequency bands, as we say, or oscillation period bands of 100 million years versus period bands of tens of seconds. That will be so exciting because the gravitational waves that we're observing would be carrying direct information about the birth of the universe. And the birth of the universe is controlled by laws of quantum gravity that we don't understand. And the challenge then of unraveling the effects of the laws of quantum gravity and the details of birth of the universe from these gravitational waves will be an extremely exciting challenge. And I think it's going to be, it could be the biggest thing going on in science in the middle of this century.
Do you think that we'll be able to learn what the conditions were that led to the Big Bang?
I hope so. I don't know. There's a question of how much information will actually be there. I think through the combination of theory, by then we may have a much better understanding of the laws of quantum gravity. And if we do, then the focus will be on using the combined laws of quantum gravity and observations to try to get a handle on the conditions that led to the Big Bang.
Lia, speaking of origins and conditions, I understand that when you were 6 years old, you told your mom you wanted to have your hair cut like Han Solo.
This
is
true.
Did she allow it?
Oh, absolutely. I think I was just initially irritated that my name Lia was so close to Princess Leia that I was like, if there was any character in this movie, I would be absolutely be Han Solo. And yes, my parents took me. I think the hairstylist was more confused that this mother was like, yeah, give her what she wants. And I got a flat top.
How did it look?
I mean, it matched my parachute pants that I was wearing and rocking while I was like breakdancing around the neighborhood. So, you know, I looked like a perfect 80s California surfer skater kid.
Well, you were born in Chicago, but grew up in the Bay Area. Mm-hmm. Your dad was a physicist, and you grew up in your father's lab at UC San Francisco. And I believe it was he who gave you your first telescope. Is that right?
My dad, I don't know actually where I got my first telescope. My dad gave me my first skateboard when I was, four years old. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. But I think the first telescope that was actually mine, I think I got when I was in college as an undergrad.
Yeah. Oh, so perhaps you were looking at his telescope in his labs.
Yeah.
What were you looking at back then?
My father studied the realm of the small. He actually studied bones. And so one of the coolest things that he did when I was young is he just encouraged a general sense of creativity and exploration. And he would say to me when I was young, oh, Lia, I'm really overwhelmed in my lab. Would you come and help me out? Do you think you would be okay getting out of kindergarten? And, you know, I thought this was a really important job that he needed help with. And he would set me up washing test tubes and just explain everything to me. You know, he was doing all sorts of experiments in the 80s that were looking at how bones were affected when we went into space. So it was very cool. I got to see the space shuttle land at Edwards Air Force Base, and I got to go to a shuttle launch, the Columbia shuttle launch in Florida. But my father was just like captivated with the world, right? Whether it was studying bones, he would stop a diesel truck driver broken down on the side of the road. Oh, what's happening with your engine? What's going on? And he just instilled this absolute passion for curiosity in me.
He also, as you mentioned, gave you your first skateboard. But you've stated that you were not invited into the culture of skateboarding in the Bay Area, and that you didn't actually meet a female skateboarder who could really skate until you were in your 20s. Why weren't you invited in when you first started?
I think skateboarding culture, it's almost hard for us to imagine what it was like in the 80s and 90s. Skateboarding was a subculture. We didn't have Tony Hawk Pro Skater. There was no X Games. So it was a subculture. And if you imagine that women were really kind of the subculture, and there were skater girlfriends hanging out at the skate park, but no one who was actually skateboarding. I think when I was, 12, 13 years old, and I was really, skateboarding ramps all the time, I was also really starting to become aware that I was queer. And I felt this very much like an outsider, even within this like subculture. The way that I would describe it is almost like a circus monkey. Like I'd show up at a skate park, and for me to be invited in there, these are not skate parks that are sponsored by the city. These are, guys getting concrete and mixing it on the weekend and, transforming spaces that you'd get kicked out of, chased by police. It was really a kind of do-it-yourself vibe that I absolutely loved. And I find that is very much akin and in parallel to being an artist. But it was very much like I had to prove myself to be able, they'd say, do a kickflip. Oh, jump over this thing. And then if I did it, then they'd be like, okay, you're cool. You can, kind of hang and stay in here. But yeah, the first time I met a female skateboarder, I was probably in my mid to early 20s.
You ended up having a half pipe in your backyard. Did you build it yourself?
Yeah, my dad and I built several ramps. I will say my dad is not just a scientist. He's an incredible surfer. He's just has a passion and love of the ocean. I grew up just south of San Francisco in a small surfing community. And my dad just always had me on a board. So, just like the haircut, I said, oh, I want to build some ramps. My dad was like, how big? How many? What shape? And we built all sorts of weird stuff in my backyard. But I think since I was probably about 9 to when I went to college, I had some kind of a skateboard ramp in my backyard that I spent most of my time on.
You were featured in Thrasher magazine when you were 15 as part of a new wave of young skateboarders. I happened to find a copy of it online, by the way.
That's incredible. I
can send you the picture
research
of you. They misspelled your name. They spelled it L-E-A, not L-I-A, but yeah. I could pick you out of the people. But since your friends had never heard of Thrasher, you still felt like the odd person out. Looking back on that now, you've said that you gained a power from that. What kind of power?
Well, when they first contacted me, they said they were going to do an all-female issue of Thrasher, which I was so excited about. And I was photographed at the time, the kind of top spots in San Francisco was Embarcadero, was photographed in the Thrasher venture ramps on the big half pipes. And then the article, I was actually photographed when I was 14 years old, and it almost was like an entire year before it came out. And I just kind of never heard anything. And then I got the information that, well, there just weren't enough women that were, or girls that were good enough to be in Thrasher. So I ended up in this article called 50 Unknowns Soon to Go Pro. And I thought, well, that can't be right because I'm a girl, no one is going to turn me into a pro skateboarder. I kind of laughed at it even at 15 years old, realizing how futile that even that title was. But it did give me this sense. It was on one hand like, oh, wow, I'm so good. I'm, being told that there's not enough women to make a whole article. But it was also just kind of like in the same way heartbreaking that there was no community there. So it was a little bit alienating. But You know, skateboarding for me is very similar to maybe the way that people talk about, more akin to surfing, because I didn't feel invited into that community. What I did fall in love with was the creativity of my body moving on the ramps and ditches and, you know, just moving through that urban space. And much of me being a young skateboarder, I was skateboarding by myself. Whereas when you think of skateboarding, you almost immediately think of that second word, skateboarding culture, right? It's like this group. And it took me until I was in my mid-20s to kind of find and form that group in a all-girl skate crew that we called ourselves Rib Death. Very serious.
Yeah, it's really, really cool. There's some fun videos I found online. Do you still skateboard?
I skateboard with my daughter nearly every couple times a week. I skate her to school, and I have two kids, a 2- and a 5-year-old, and they're really into the scooters, but I haven't gotten them completely addicted to the skateboard yet. But little Atlas at 2 years old, I think he's my best promise. He'll like stand on it and pull it out. So I think I have a second wind in me of being a skateboarder by kind of translating that love to my kids. But yeah, Jas and I skate to school a couple times a week.
When you were 15 years old, you asked your parents if you could have your birthday party at an exploratorium. Why did you want to have it there?
These are great questions, Debbie. So when I was 15, I had gone on a field trip, I think the year before, to this hands-on physics museum in San Francisco. And there's 9,000 exhibits at the Exploratorium. It was at the Palace of Fine Arts, just a beautiful place. And they have something there called the tactile dome, completely dark. It's not a maze. You can't get lost, but you are led through these tunnels, and everything is, you can't see your hand in front of your face. And you try to move through this space. And when I was there on a field trip, they were saying, oh, you could rent out the tactile dome. And so I think the year later, I told my parents, like, that's what I want to do, is go to the tactile dome.
You ended up getting your first job there as well, initially conducting cow eye dissections and laser demonstrations, and then in the machine shop where you learned how to build and use a sandblaster and a lathe. At that time, did you think you wanted to be a scientist?
You know, I knew, I would say, even from my early Han Solo 6-year-old days, that I wanted to be an artist. But I was really passionate about learning how to build things. And I think for me, the idea of science was always intrinsically tied to what being an artist and making could be. So even though I was like my first job working in a science museum, everything that I did there, I just thought that was somehow like supporting me being an artist in some way. It was like a vehicle to study the thing that I was going to make work about. So, you know, working in the machine shop, I apprenticed under a really amazing builder, Tom Tompkins. And I felt like that was truly the foundation for me to go to art school. I learned how to build everything, the lathe, the end mill, like you said, the sandblaster. Every weekend, Tom would throw some weird thing at me and say, you know, I need 100 of these knobs and they have to be to a 1/100th of an inch. And just gave me such a dedication and passion for precision, for refining your craft, for really understanding how things work. And, you know, if you kind of didn't understand it, you know, we would absolutely just take the thing apart. And so it was an amazing way to, you know, building a museum exhibit, you're building something to try to share something with someone that has never existed before. Very similar to art making.
You got your BA from UCLA and went on to get an MFA in painting and printmaking from Yale University. Micheline Thomas and Kehinde Wiley were two of your classmates. Paul McCarthy was one of your favorite professors at UCLA. And you said that one of the favorite things he told you was that after he makes something, it could take upwards of 6 months to really understand what he did. How did that influence you?
I mean, that was a really profound thing to hear when you're in school from someone that you just admire so much, right? In school, you're the structure of a semester. You're supposed to come up with an idea and follow it and execute it and defend it in a critique. And to have someone that was so ingrained in making and would let their studio practice lead them through that making to what the content was, that was just so freeing to me. It just gave me like a big open space to be extremely exploratory. That's one of my favorite things that anyone said to me as an undergrad. I pass that on to my students, and I think about it all the time. When I'm lost in my studio, I don't know what I'm doing. I actually find great comfort in the unknown at this point because of that, to think like, you know, you have plenty of time to figure out what it is. And through the act of physically being creative, your body and your intuitive marks will tell you something about the thing that you're doing, more so than thinking about it can.
This fall, I'm finding myself busier than ever, and I've needed to rely on some ways to take better care of myself. I've come to depend on HelloFresh to help me do just that. Ordering my meals with HelloFresh means I don't need to spend all evening cooking in the kitchen. With their quick and easy recipes and 15-minute meals, I can get a delicious dinner on the table in less time than it takes to order out. And the food is fantastic. When I get HelloFresh, I know I'm getting top-notch produce since it travels from the farm to my door in less than 7 days. Now you can enjoy it too, for way less. Go to HelloFresh.com/50DesignMatters and use the code 50DesignMatters for 50% off plus 15% off the next 2 months. That's HelloFresh.com/50DesignMatters and use the code 50DesignMatters for 50% off plus 15% off for the next 2 months. Enjoy!
Throughout history, women defied expectations and dared to be different. Join the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum in Boston, Massachusetts, to explore how art, fashion, and photography shaped their identities. Isabella Stewart Gardner, an enigmatic figure, used these mediums to craft her image. Her story is rich with defiance of gender and class norms, shrouded in tales and myths. Inventing Isabella features her portraits, clothing, and jewelry, revealing how she collaborated with artists to shape her public persona. The museum also highlights two contemporary artists, Fabiola Jean-Louise and Carla Fernandez. Dare to be different. Join us at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum to experience three powerful exhibitions and women. Inventing Isabella, Fabiola Jean-Louise, Rewriting History, and Carla Fernandez, Tradition is Not Static. On view now through January 15th.
I want to talk a bit about some of your early projects before we talk about your collaboration with Kip. In 2009, you began working on a performance-based photographic series called Dark Skate, using long exposure photography to document the trajectories of your movements on a skateboard at night. The series consists of site-specific, two-dimensional images that are part photograph, part performance, and part self-portrait drawings. Dark State has been described as an exploration of relationships generated between the body and space, expressing the universal and intimate qualities of each. What inspired this piece?
Well, I think as an artist, I kind of do things without thinking, just that I'm drawn to and I want to explore. And then they turn out to then be ingrained in my art practice. So I don't think that I ever set out to make a project that was about skateboarding. But because skateboarding is such a huge part of my history, I was really interested in answering the question, how could I make work that embodied the way that I could express myself physically through space? And to me, one of the spaces that I'm the most free and exploratory is through skateboarding. And I loved that I would be actually setting a project that kind of documented my physical limitations of what I could do. So in this series, I attach a light to my body and I'm skateboarding bowls in the pitch dark. Well, a lot of people think, oh, that's you know, kind of outrageous, or it's such an extreme idea, but it's actually not. It's muscle memory. I mean, I have just, you know, like we talked about my childhood, I've spent so much of my life on a skateboard on a ramp that it actually is really very much like a self-portrait. And in so much of my work, it's really important to have an intimate connection to whatever I'm making my subject matter and to put myself in it. So even though you don't see a photograph of me, I also think that people in a lot of ways are surprised that there is a female skateboarder, a queer body that is a skateboarder. I, you know, fly planes. People are surprised that there would be a female skateboarder. All those things, it's like, it's very subtle, but it's really important as an artist to, you know, to represent those, you know, those spaces. And so dark skate is really so much, it's like I think of them as double portraits. It's the portrait of the city, the urban space, the explorer, myself, the self-portrait of me, you know, within those spaces.
They're absolutely haunting and quite beautiful. You were in a show with Guggenheim called Haunted, mm-hmm. Contemporary Photography Video Performance, and the curators placed your work in the section of performance. Did that surprise you?
I loved that. I mean, I felt that I always tried to tell everyone in these pieces that I'm not really the photographer. The photography is the necessary intersection to document those movements. So I just thought it was absolutely perfect because when I'm moving in that space, I am being very inventive and you're just, you know, you capture this kind of glimmer and a moment, the photograph kind of flattens it out, but it's so akin to making, you know, a mark, a line, a gesture. You know, you can find reference in drawing and also just, you know, the body moving through space. One of the most influential things in conceptually thinking about this space is every time I would go surfing with my dad, which was every Saturday when I was growing up in Pacifica, I would be like eagerly trying to get into the ocean and he'd say, hang on, let's take a look. And he'd always want to watch the ocean. I was so impatient. And he'd say, where are you going? What wave are you going on? Are you going left? Or are you going right? Where are you paddling out? And he, from that age, I always imagined, I think I started projecting this like line coming out of my chest that I would look and find my way on the wave. So then before getting to the ocean, I'd say, okay, we're going to paddle through that channel and we're going to sit on the crest of that wave and we're going to, you know, take the wave to the right. And that to me was also like so much of what dark skate was like inserting my own personal kind of like intimate way of reinterpreting the urban space around me.
Lia, you said that not only is your work about science or drawing from science, but the process itself always has an experimental quality. And I understand you'd never made a cyanotype before you began the series. Your body is a space that sees, and it took you 6 months to master the process. Was that process enjoyable? Is that experimental phase one that you find fulfilling, even if you don't have an outcome that you can foresee?
I think it's actually the most exciting because it's like it can be anything. You're determining what the thing can be through the experiment. So making a, you know, cyanotype to take 6 months, it sounds like a lot, but we're, you know, me and my studio team really trying to figure out how to make these things on a really large scale.
Kip, what about you? Do you find the process of going through the unknown something that is enjoyable, or is it, does it produce anxiety and tension because you don't know what the outcome is? And, you know, in your case, spending decades on something where you don't know if you're going to get a result, how do you manage that? How do you calibrate that experience into your psyche?
As Ray Weiss, my MIT soulmate, says, it was such great fun that we didn't ever get discouraged. The whole process is exciting. It's more enjoyable in many ways than the discovery itself.
that's sort of how it feels like making art, you know, being in the studio, creating, discovering something. It has the potential for kind of anythingness, especially when I don't know what the medium will, where it will take me. When it's done, then it goes, you know, it goes off, it goes to a gallery, it has another life. And then you're just, I feel like then I transform back into a viewer and I stop becoming the maker. But I kind of ended up getting into everything that I do because I love the making. I love the, you know, sitting in that unknown and the opportunity to find something new that could surprise or shock me in my own studio. How like wonderful could that be to then show someone what that could become?
You two met at a cocktail party in Pasadena in 2007. Lia, is it true that you overheard someone say Kip's name and you went up to him and effusively and unapologetically shared how much of an impact his writing had had on your artwork?
Absolutely. And so much so that the woman he was talking to under her breath, but loud enough for me to hear, uttered "physics groupie" to me.
Kip, did that scare you at all?
No.
How do you manage the physics groupies?
it just goes with the territory, unfortunately. So what has been difficult for me was I win the Nobel Prize, I become an icon, which is what they want. The Nobel committee wants icons for science. I'm uncomfortable being an icon. I don't want to be an icon, but I am, and I've just gotten used to it. And so I more or less try to ignore it and try to just be Kip.
Kip, as Lia told you what she did, you realized that a filmmaker who was interested in making a movie that engaged some of your science needed someone who could help make drawings and paintings of black holes and wormholes to help convey the ideas. And the film ended up being the 2014 film Interstellar. And while the original director was Steven Spielberg, you ended up working with the director Christopher Nolan. But it was Spielberg you had to convince to not use a spaceship that could travel faster than the speed of light. Is that correct?
No, that one was Christopher Nolan.
Oh, it was Christopher Nolan?
Yes.
Oh, I'm disappointed in Christopher Nolan. I thought that he was smarter than that.
In reality, his whole attitude was one of pushing the envelope. Mm. And he had discovered in his conversation with me very early that I could make pronouncements and I could turn out to be wrong. That's one of the, my PhD advisor, John Wheeler, used to say, the greatest physicists are the ones who make the most mistakes the most rapidly on their way to the truth. Mm-hmm. And I could frequently be wrong. And Chris would say to me, I would like such and so. For example, he said, I would like 1 hour on Miller's planet in the movie, the water planet, is 7 years back on Earth. And I said to him immediately, that's not possible. And he said to me, you go do a real calculation. By then he knew the foundation is to do a real calculation of the real laws of physics, not just guess. And so I went off and did a real calculation. And sure enough, he was right. I was wrong. This was possible. It was very extreme, but it was possible. And so he had this experience of me making pronouncements. And then when he pushes me to the wall, I go check for absolutely sure. And I'm shocked to find I was wrong. So when he said that he wanted to go back to Earth faster than the speed of light, I told him, absolutely, that's not possible. That time I was right.
You
I
prevailed.
Right. I prevailed. But the interchange with Christopher Nolan was an enormous pleasure. We worked together productively with a give and take. It was very similar to my interactions with Lia. I've had two wonderful collaborators in Chris and in Lia.
Interstellar is one of, if not my favorite movie of all time. Well, maybe that and Arrival and Contact. And you also consulted on Contact with Carl Sagan. Lia, I understand that you created over 250 paintings based on Kip's scientific writings. Did that mean you had to fully understand them?
Huh, that's a good question. Is there a test in the end here, Kip?
No. I'm just really curious.
Well, I think that for the book, we've actually, there's 100 and probably 150 paintings that appear in the book. And we've counted up now to about 668 is last week's count. The reason that they keep going is we're going through all the old archive because over 13 years I've made all, you know, so many different iterations. And I think that through drawing and through painting, I would get closer to understanding what Kip was talking about. So some of the things like black holes and wormholes, I already had peripheral information and knowledge and had taken many classes on these things and just a totally separate interest before meeting Kip, which is why I was so excited to meet him. But through our conversations, Kip would just explain it a little bit different, just a different entry point. And I'd make a painting. And in a weird way, the way that even Paul McCarthy was talking about, I would sort of learn something by even me making the painting. Then Kip would look at it and nudge it in a different direction, say, well, why doesn't it go a little bit more like this? Or the tendexes should be spinning a little bit more like this. And so I think through our conversations and through the visualizations, those things would bring me to understanding the topics within our book even more so than reading.
Kip, you've said that you could see the spirit of science captured in Lia's drawings in a way that people who are not physicists could get some real sense of what they were. Do you think that ideas expressed visually are easier to comprehend than verbally?
Different people's minds work differently. For me, visualization of ideas is very powerful. My mind operates visually. When I'm doing research, mathematics is the language of science. Mathematics is the ultimate arbiter that tells me what the laws of physics are predicting. But the visualization is the thing that enables me to make leaps of insight, and with those leaps of insight, decide what mathematical calculations to do in order to verify whether or not my leaps of insight are correct. So when I'm thinking about physics, I'm almost always thinking in terms of visualizations and not in terms of the mathematics. It's only when I'm trying to get things nailed down for sure that I turn to the mathematics. And so going from my thinking of physics to communicating with Lia or more generally with the non-scientist public, the visualizations are the natural tool. They just carry right over from my research right into the conversation.
You're about to publish a new book together, a book that has been nearly two decades in the making. It is titled The Warped Side of the Universe, An Odyssey Through Black Holes, Wormholes, Time Travel, and Gravitational Waves. Now, is it true that this book began with an article you were asked to write and illustrate for Playboy magazine?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
tell us more about that.
Is that a natural way for a book to begin?
Absolutely. Yeah, between that and Penthouse, we're getting this all covered.
Listen, we have Thrasher in there, too. You see a theme.
That's true. There is a theme. I love it.
This was the era when Playboy was trying to distinguish itself from other men's magazines by having what they regarded as high-quality interviews, high-quality literature. And so the editor that I had on a previous book I had written called Black Holes and Time Warps had become literary editor at Playboy magazine. And she contacted me and asked if I would write an article about warped space-time for Playboy. And I said, yes, but I would like to bring on Lia to do paintings as part of the article. She and the art director at Playboy looked at some of Lia's paintings on the web and came back very enthusiastic. And so we got a contract with Playboy magazine to do this. We moved forward and we submitted then an article that I've forgotten. It was maybe 3,000 or 4,000 words long and had four or five of Lia's paintings in it. And fairly quickly, we got a response. Lia, you want to describe the response?
Well, I was personally rejected by Hugh Hefner, which I wear as a badge of honor.
Now, he rejected the paintings. Why?
Well, they weren't up to Playboy's standards, he said. I don't think that I had properly objectified these women, is essentially what it came down to.
Yeah, that is definitely a badge of honor.
Yeah. And I thought I was like being subversive because for the models, I had used different queer and trans women. And I was like, this is the first time they're going to be in Playboy magazine and no one will know. Then, Hugh Hefner said that, my paintings did not live up to the Playboy standards.
And you also featured your wife as one of the models, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Very, very beautiful woman. So his mistake.
Well, the good news is for Kip is that all those original paintings that were supposed to be in Playboy existed. And when we transformed them into a book, Kip got all the originals. So he has he has one hanging behind him right now.
Yes. Here in my office. A beautiful painting of Lia's wife. Yes.
Well, since this is a podcast, we can't see it, but maybe we can post it when the show goes live. And people can't see the book, so I want to actually describe it a little bit. It was designed by the legendary artist and designer Rebecca Mendez. It has 240 luscious coffee table sized pages, a stunning jacket. It includes more than 100 magnificent four color paintings by Lia throughout. It has multiple gatefolds. And the text is an epic prose poem written by Kip. What made you both decide to make this book like this book?
I mean, the way this book came to be is such a good force for collaboration, because I don't think that we ever set out to make what you just described. What we did set out to was to have these conversations and to continue with what we started in making for Playboy. And we called it our little book for years. We thought, oh, it'll be 30, 40 pages, because what happened was every time Kip and I would get together, we'd have these wonderful conversations. Then I would make more paintings and Kip would look at the paintings and he'd extend the writing. And then I'd look at the writing and then I'd make more paintings and it would go back and forth and back and forth. But I would say we never intended to make what it looks like now. It's almost like the book made itself, or the collaboration and our friendship and our love for each other, and of just sort of making the book that we would want to read based on black holes and wormholes and time travel. It told us what it needed to be.
And I never intended that it would be poetry or verse. It was prose originally, but I had always, in all of my writing, even very technical writing, worked hard to polish the prose so that it was really understandable, so it flowed beautifully, and so it was a pleasure to read. That's what I had done with this Playboy prose. And early on, after we decided we'd make it into a little book, Lia had a friend lay it out as a book, and that friend happened to break up on two facing pages, happened to break my prose into stanzas. It was a particular piece that naturally got broken into stanzas. But I looked at that and I had an epiphany. I realized that because I had worked so hard to polish the prose so that it flowed beautifully, it could be turned into verse. And as I experimented with turning it into verse, I then came to realize that this combination of tightly integrated verse and paintings could convey the essence of the science that I was talking about, the warped space and time, black holes, wormholes, the Big Bang, could convey, gravitational waves, could convey the essence of that much more powerfully than the standard kind of writing I had always done for the non-scientists of prose together with illustrations. This is very different. The verse is simultaneously more constraining and more liberating. More liberating in the sense of opening myself up to focusing on the essence of what is going on, the beauty and the essence of it, instead of focusing on getting all the fine details right. And I think this was an epiphany for me, but it's really an epiphany probably for Lia and me together, as we jointly came to understand the power of this combination.
Yeah, I think it was also a moment for me to realize that we could make something that would possibly embody and really offer a wide invitation to these things that people are very curious and passionate about, but feel maybe intimidated by, you know, didactic writing in mathematics, that could we have an entry point? Could we make something that wasn't just the science or the art, but it was like this third thing where the text and the paintings really, they supported each other. Like you need one to have the other.
Mm. Did you get the manuscript first, Lia, and then make the paintings, or were you collaborating back and forth, sort of volleying?
Yeah, that's how it was made. So it was made in a very untraditional way. Kip didn't have something that I then, quote, illustrated. That's why we, you know, I really think of them as paintings, not illustrations. A lot of times I would make a painting and I'd show to Kip and Kip would look at it and then he would write based on looking at the painting, and then he'd send me things, and then I would pick out what to me. He would never say, like, make a painting about this. He would send me different passages, and then I would say, okay, if I want to understand what was the essence and the ethos of what we're trying to, like, communicate here. And maybe it's one painting. And sometimes I'd say, okay, this short passage, we need five paintings here, because that's to me what could create what we came to describe, which was like, we want a book that transfers someone into a total experience, an experience of the universe.
Yeah. I spend an inordinate amount of time thinking about how we got here, what we're made of, et cetera. And I was a little bit intimidated by the book because I'm limited only by what I don't know when it comes to thinking about these things. And that's a lot. So I actually decided I was going to read the glossary first. I went through the book and I saw there was a glossary. And I'm like, let me read the glossary so I could really get a sense of these terms. And then read it with a little feeling like I had a little bit more sort of a foundation. And I actually found that you don't need to do that. You don't need to do that.
No.
It's so beautifully, understandably rich that it's nice to have the glossary, because I think it's a way to go back and say, oh, I know what a gravitational wave is now. It's this. Or I know what the bulk is. It's this. But to have it, this sort of, it's almost like a piece of music that you're going through, and the prose and the art are so intertwined.
Yeah.
It's really quite a marvelous journey to go through the book.
Yeah.
Lia, you say that your collaboration presents one aspect of art and science. And I'm wondering if you can describe that aspect.
Well, the collaboration for the book, it just gave me an opportunity to make something that I would never make in and of myself in my studio. I exist in this strange art world where, you know, a studio artist, like, I make things often alone in my studio, sometimes on large scale works. I have an amazing studio team. And then those things, where do they go? They go to galleries or museums. And oftentimes I don't see them again, or there's a show, it gets put up, we celebrate it, and then they kind of go away. This collaboration on a large scale, I'm really interested in accessibility in art. That's, you know, I'm a professor and chair of the art department at Chapman University. I think of teaching as a complete extension of my studio practice. It's not just like something that I do, but often when I'm thinking of an idea, and I'm in that period that we've talked about before with Paul McCarthy of like figuring out what it is, often I'll write a course that I then share with my students. So I think of collaboration with my students, with Kip. I've had other collaborations in the past that have just been so fruitful in getting me to understand the thing that I'm curious about. And the way that I sort of envision it, and because I am so visual, I often have these sort of mind exercises, is like, if I'm thinking about a black hole, I would like imagine that I'm putting that thing sort of in the middle of the room, and then I circle it from all different aspects. So maybe one of those might be making a drawing about it. Another thing is reading one type of writing about it. Another way would be looking at how did someone else depict it? You know, just really engaging and enmeshing myself in a community of other thinkers. So I think of collaboration as being absolutely integral in my studio practice, not only for the concepts and the development of a subject matter, but actually for the technical exploration. You had, you know, asked me how I've ever made a cyanotype before, but I made another piece in the last couple of years called Double Horizon, where I took several cameras and I attached them to the external parts of a Cessna plane while I was learning how to fly. And that came from, I just thought to myself, how could I represent time and time-based piece that also engaged what a landscape could be? And then I thought, well, of course it has to be time-based, but I had no idea what that was. So I was basically flying around, recording flights for 2 years, but that took an exceptional amount of collaboration because I'm not a videographer. I'm not an editor. I'm not a sound person. You know, I got to, you know, and honestly, it just, these collaborations, it has been so, it has just been so rewarding in my life because it gets me to meet and work with so many incredible people. You know, I mean, as we talk about the book coming up for its release, I mean, Kip and I, you know, talk on the phone and Zoom and see each other, you know, on a weekly basis for how many years. And I'm like, we've got to get another project going because it's been just so amazing to, you know, the reason we wanted to make this was just so we could work together.
Well, Double Horizon is stunning. It actually, when I was looking at the photographs, it reminded me a little bit of the planet that Murph lives on at the end of Interstellar.
Yeah.
How sort of time is bending on top of itself.
Yeah.
Kip, I want to ask if you'll read a short excerpt from the book so people can get a sense of the prose. But before that, I just wanted to ask you one question. Early in the book, you state this: for decades, a beast materially composed, have been consumed by quests to fully comprehend this warped side of our universe. How? Through tricks of mathematics and computer simulations, probing Albert Einstein's relativity equation. So my question is, how do you come up with the tricks of mathematics to better understand parts of the universe we didn't even know existed?
Well, mathematics is the language of the universe. Mathematics is the language of the physical laws that control the universe. We have two ways to really explore with confidence the universe. If we have confidence in our physical laws, then it's a matter of working with those mathematical laws. And mathematical tricks are a major part of working with those laws to figure out what the predictions are for what may be going on out there. And then going out and doing observations, such as our observations with LIGO, with gravitational waves. Those are the essential final tools for firm understanding, the manipulation of the mathematical laws and the observations. We've been talking about the visualization in paintings, our mental visualization. Those are the essence of the intuition that enables us to make great leaps of understanding. The mathematics is really very central to the deep understanding.
Will you be willing to read us
sure.
a little excerpt sure. from the book? Sure. Tell us what you're going to read.
So I'm going to read the beginning of the prologue that basically explains what the book is all about. It introduces the warped side of the universe, which is what appears in the title of the book. And the challenge, the excitement of our first contact as human beings with the warp side of the universe.
Wonderful.
Our universe is varied and vast. Galaxies, planets, stars and moons, quasars, pulsars and magnetars, all made from atoms and molecules, just like you and me, and all that we hear and touch and see. Our universe is also endowed with a marvelous shadowy side that is warped. Phenomena forged from warped space-time. Witness the ravenous fat black hole that Lia here depicts ingesting her wife, Felicia. I'm going to stop reading and just make a comment. The verse by itself is pretty dry. it is pretty sparse.
Oh, Kip, no, no.
And without no. the paintings, it's pretty sparse. And so you have to understand that to really experience this, you need the paintings side by side with the painting here of Lia's wife, Felicia, being ingested by a black hole is so powerful as it ties so tightly into the verse.
I disagree. I mean, I think it's that, yes, the experience of the book as one unit is wonderful, but the prose is really beautiful.
Okay, well, I'll move on.
Okay.
Although this warped side is entwined in the weft of our matter-filled universe, its stars, its planets and nebulae, its galaxies and its comets, we humans never saw it until just recently. Why did we never see? Warped space-time cannot produce light or other signals that yesterday's technology was able to perceive. So now, how has that changed? A very long time ago, a billion years in the past, while here on Earth, multicelled life arose and spread around the globe, but in a galaxy far, far away, two spinning black holes danced round one another, rippling the fabric of space and time. The ripples, we call them gravity waves, sucked energy from the holes' orbits, so the holes spiraled inward, eclipsing each other toward a climactic collision. The holes, at half of light speed, catastrophically collided and merged in a brief cataclysmic storm of writhing and twisting space-time that brought the waves to crescendo. The climaxing gravity waves from this catastrophic collision surged out of their birthing galaxy and into interstellar space. Spreading across our universe for nearly a billion years, they stretched and they squeezed all that they met, stars and planets and nebulae, in patterns that encoded a portrait of their birth, colliding holes and space-time storm. Then, 50,000 years ago, when humans shared Earth with Neanderthals, the spreading and weakening gravity waves sailed into our spiral-armed Milky Way, our galaxy, our home. On September 14th of 2015, near the Antarctic Peninsular tip, the waves flying upward plunged into the Earth through air, then rough oceans, then rock, whispering up through Earth's bowels unscathed and emerging just north of New Orleans. The gravity waves came face to face with a complex and huge L-shaped invention designed and built to perceive them, LIGO, the Laser Interferometer Gravity Wave Observatory. Flowing through LIGO, the gravity waves stretched and then squeezed microscopically two very long beams of bouncing light that extracted the portraits the waves had encoded, colliding holes and space-time storm. This tiny shudder in LIGO was momentous for the whole human race, our very first moment of contact with the warped side of our universe.
Thank you. I have three last questions for you both today. First one is for Lia. Lia, do you have any plans to have an exhibition to show off the full-size paintings that are featured in the book?
Yes, I have a solo show opening on November 4th with my gallery here in LA, Luis de Jesus, and we will be showing a collection of the original art from the book. And then I've made a larger piece that celebrates each of the chapters as an expansion of the book itself. And then we're also, we've made a print so that we kind of wanted to make something that was like an extension of a special edition of the book. So a print will also be available for the first 2 weeks that the book comes out to celebrate its release. And you can find all that on the information for the exhibition in Los Angeles on my website at Luis de Jesus Los Angeles, and the print information is on those sites as well.
Wonderful. Kip, my next question is for you. You know that I went to high school with David Spergel, the MacArthur Fellow, former professor of astronomy at Princeton University, and currently the president of the Simons Foundation, and I told him that I was interviewing you today, and I asked him if he had any burning questions for you. And this is what he responded with. Question from David Spergel. Among the many fascinating things that Kip has thought about, one of my favorite topics, and one that will likely be of interest to your listeners, is closed timeline curves, the possibility that we could travel back in time. Kip has thought deeply about how closed timeline curves change the structure of reality. Self-consistency requires that you don't kill your grandmother before you were born, but like in Back to the Future, you could help your father meet your mother. David's question is this. I have wondered whether closed timeline curves are stable to quantum fluctuations. Could the photon travel back in time and then circle around endlessly, back and forth in time, getting brighter and brighter?
I think that David was feeding that to me to get me to respond the following way. He knows a lot about my thinking on this. This process that if you had a time machine and you first turn it on, then a photon could be the first thing to travel through it, could go through the time machine and come back, arriving back at the very same place as it started, at the same moment as it started. And now you have two photons there at the same point in space and time. You have the original one and you have the older one that's made the trip. And then those two can go around and come back to where they started. Now you have four. And so what began as one photon can wind up as being an enormous number of photons. In fact, that could build up so explosively, it might destroy the time machine at the moment that it gets turned on. And this was a question raised for me by two colleagues at the University of Chicago when I was thinking about time machines and closed timeline curves. And it triggered me to ask the question in a little more sophisticated way. I can save the time machine by just simply blocking the photon so it can't go through. And so then I'll still have a time machine. But there's something I can't block, and that is fluctuations of what we call virtual photons, quantum fluctuations of light. These quantum fluctuations of light are unstoppable, and they're unremovable. And so I sat down with a postdoc some years ago and did the same analysis and discovered that these quantum fluctuations going through this incipient time machine, what was just first being turned on, do create a gigantic explosion. Stephen Hawking and a student of his did a similar calculation about the same time. And we then got into a big argument between ourselves. It appeared to me that the explosion would be strong enough to destroy the time machine. It appeared to him that it might not be. And as we went back and forth, we came to realize that the answer as to whether it's strong enough that all time machines will always be destroyed when you first turn them on, whether that's the case or not, it was held tightly in the grip of these poorly understood laws of quantum gravity. So there we are. We don't understand the laws of quantum gravity well enough to be sure whether time machines always self-destruct when you turn them on. There's a whole chapter about this in our book. And Lia even invented a very simple version of this that you have to read in the last part of that chapter. A variant that is much easier to understand than what I just said. It's a wonderful part of the collaboration was the elaboration that
absolutely.
Lia did.
Absolutely. Didn't Stephen Hawking have a party for future physicists to come back in time and had food and drink and no one showed up?
No one showed up. That's right.
Well, since we're speaking speculatively, I have one last question for both of you. What do you think the chances are of there being extraterrestrial life in the universe?
As a artist who is so influenced by reading about science and hearing about it from all aspects, I think that because I'm not a scientist, I get very excited hearing from different ways that we're creatively thinking about what people are doing at JPL and what they're sampling and what they're doing. And I think that it seems very unlikely that there is not life out there. you know, there's probably much more well said by Carl Sagan that, you know, what a lonely place it would be if there wasn't. But
big waste of space.
Yeah. And I think, you know, in the same way that Kip is looking at what the next generation of LIGO can be, I feel like what an exciting time to bear witness that I think within our lifetimes, we're going to be able to see what those life forms are. I'm really excited to see what the mission to Europa being built by JPL is going to show. Yes, it's going to be tiny little unexciting, you know, microcosms of life, but and not a multi-celled body. But I vote yes enthusiastically.
Kip, what about you?
Well, let me describe a gathering that I had when we were just working on the movie Interstellar, when Steven Spielberg was the director in the early creative phase. It was at Caltech. We brought together, I think, 18 scientists from around the United States who were experts in various aspects of the science that was going to be in the movie. And Steven himself, he posed toward the end of our discussion, it was an all-day discussion, he posed the question, how many of you think that it is very likely that there are civilizations out there, that advanced civilizations out in the universe besides our own? And every hand went up. All 18 scientists said they thought it was very likely. And I was surprised at that. I wasn't surprised that it was a majority, but I was a little surprised that it was everybody. People who are experts on astrobiology, experts in quantum physics, experts in rocketry. But everybody, including me, thought it quite likely.
Kip Thorne, Lia Halloran, thank you so much for making so much work that matters, for helping us comprehend the magic and the science of the warp side of the universe. And thank you for joining me today on Design Matters.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for having us.
Kip Thorne and Lia Halloran's new book is titled The Warp Side of the Universe, An Odyssey Through Black Holes, Wormholes, Time Travel, and Gravitational Waves. You can read more about Lia Halloran at liahalloran.com and more about Kip at nobelprize.org. This is the 18th year we've been podcasting Design Matters, and I'd like to thank you for listening. And remember, we can talk about making a difference, we can make a difference, or we can do both. I'm Debbie Millman, and I look forward to talking with you again soon.
Design Matters is produced for the TED Audio Collective by Curtis Fox Productions. The interviews are usually recorded at the Masters in Branding program at the School of Visual Arts in New York City, the first and longest-running branding program in the world. The editor-in-chief of Design Matters Media is Emily Weiland.